Signori, buonasera, benvenuti alla casa italiana zerilli-marimò. We are delighted to have with us tonight this fantastic panel of women to talk about women, literature and translation. The occasion of this panel is the publication of the new English translation of A Family Lexicon by Natalia Ginzburg. And we are delighted that on top of the people that you've seen on the invitation, we have a guest of honor from Italy, and it's Alessandra Ginzburg, the daughter of Natalia Ginzburg. Please welcome her with an applause. And I'm not going to take too much time because I have my wonderful colleague Ruth Ben-Ghiat, who is going to introduce her guest and to moderate the roundtable. Just allow me a personal debt of my own gratitude to Natalia Ginzburg, because in my first year of high school, my first composition, I wrote a long composition, and the teacher said, it's excellent, it's very good, but there is a mistake that is unforgivable for somebody who wants to become a teacher of Italian. I said, what have I done? I said, you wrote familiare with a G, and familiare goes with an L because it comes from Latin familiaris. And I said, but it's in Natalia Ginzburg's title. And so she reconsidered and she gave me a good grade. So I have this personal devotion to Natalia Ginzburg. And as you might know, there were two books that came out more or less at the same time. One was Cronache Familiari, and one was Lessico Familiare, one with the G, one with no G. So the controversy continues. I assume this is not something that our panel is going to touch upon tonight. And I would like to briefly introduce Ruth Ben-Ghiat, who is a professor of history and Italian studies here at New York University. Ruth specializes in contemporary Italy, especially issues related to fascism. Her latest book is Italian Fascism, Empire, Cinema. And she's also a frequent contributor for CNN, and she's also appearing in several other medias. And more recently, she has taken a more, even more contemporary approach, and her very special insight on Italian fascism has provided very useful to read, analyze, and study contemporary American society. Yes, it's sad, but Ruth does that very well. So without further ado, please welcome Ruth Ben-Ghiat.
So, yes, our last member of our all-star panel. So I'm going to introduce everyone at the outset and then go over a little bit what the format of the evening will be. And then we'll begin. It's a very rich evening. So I want to start with our guest of honor, because we are here to celebrate Natalia Ginzburg and Jenny McPhee's translation of this book. And Jenny is a translator, most obviously, a novelist, an essayist, and she's translated also works by Primo Levi, Giacomo Leopardi, Curzio Malaparte, and even Pope John Paul II. Very versatile. She is currently working on books by Anna Maria Ortese and Elsa Morante, and she is also our colleague here at NYU. She directs the Center for Applied Liberal Arts at NYU's School of Professional Studies. We also have Anne Goldstein, who is a former New Yorker editor, and she's everyone knows her translations of Primo Levi, Pier Paolo Pasolini, Elena Ferrante, and Alessandro Baricco. And she's the editor of the complete works of Primo Levi in English. And Jhumpa, Lahiri is the author of four works of fiction in English and two books in Italian, including The Interpreter of Maladies, which won the Pulitzer Prize. She's recently translated Ties by Domenico Starnone from Italian into English. She teaches creative writing and translation at Princeton. We have Giovanna Calvino, who has a PhD in French and Italian literature from the University of Pennsylvania, and she taught here for many years, NYU as our colleague, and she manages the literary estate of Italo Calvino, her father, and is the author of a children's book and a skilled translator and literary critic herself. We have Lynne Sharon Schwartz, who's the author of many novels, story collections, and books of poetry. She has translated Ginzburg's essays in the volume entitled A Place to Live, Selected Essays of Natalia Ginzburg. She teaches at the Bennington Writing Seminars and at Columbia's School of the Arts. So that is everyone, and we have, of course, Alessandra Ginzburg, who needs no other introduction other than what Stefano has told us. So what Jenny and I did is we're going to pose a question to everybody, and after a few questions we'll have a discussion. So we'll alternate kind of individual interventi and discussions, and we hope at the end we will have Alessandra's reactions to all of this. But we will begin with Giovanna, who is going to read in Italian, the author's preface of Ginzburg, and then Jenny will read it, and also a short excerpt of her work, because translation celebrations of translations are should have readings of the prose themselves. So let's begin with Giovanna.
Avvertenza, va bene? Luoghi, fatti e persone sono in questo libro reali. Non ho inventato niente e ogni volta che sulle tracce del mio vecchio costume di romanziera inventavo, mi sentivo subito spinta a distruggere quanto avevo inventato. Anche i nomi sono reali. Sentendo io nello scrivere questo libro una così profonda intolleranza per ogni invenzione, non ho potuto cambiare i nomi veri, che mi sono apparsi indissolubili dalle persone vere. Forse a qualcuno dispiacerà di trovarsi così col suo nome e cognome in un libro, ma a questo non ho nulla da rispondere. Ho scritto soltanto quello che ricordavo. Perciò, se si legge questo libro come una cronaca, si obietterà che presenta infinite lacune. Benché tratto dalla realtà, penso che si debba leggerlo come se fosse un romanzo, e cioè senza chiedergli nulla di più né di meno di quello che un romanzo può dare. E vi sono anche molte cose che pure ricordavo e che ho tralasciato di scrivere, e fra queste molte che mi riguardavano direttamente. Non avevo molta voglia di parlare di me. Questa, difatti, non è la mia storia, ma piuttosto, pur con vuoti e lacune, la storia della mia famiglia. Devo aggiungere che, nel corso della mia infanzia e adolescenza, mi proponevo sempre di scrivere un libro che raccontasse delle persone che vivevano allora intorno a me. Questo è in parte quel libro, ma solo in parte, perché la memoria è labile e perché i libri tratti dalla realtà non sono spesso che esili barlumi e schegge di quanto abbiamo visto e udito.
Author's preface. The places, events, and people in this book are real. I haven't invented a thing, and each time I found myself slipping into my long-held habits as a novelist and made something up, I was quickly compelled to destroy the invention. The names are also real. In the writing of this book, I felt such a profound intolerance for any fiction. I couldn't bring myself to change the real names, which seemed to me indissoluble from the real people. Perhaps someone will be unhappy to find themselves so, with his or her first and last name in a book. To this, I have nothing to say. I have written only what I remember. If read as a history, one will object to the infinite lacunae. Even though the story is real, I think one should read it as if it were a novel, and therefore not demand of it any more or less than a novel can offer. There are also many things that I do remember, but decided not to write about. Among these, much that concerned me directly. I have little desire to talk about myself. This is not, in fact, my story, but rather, even with gaps and lacunae, the story of my family. I must add that during my childhood and adolescence, I always thought about writing a book about the people whom I lived with and who surrounded me at the time. This is, in part, that book, but only in part, because memory is ephemeral, and because books based on reality are often only faint glimpses and fragments of what we have seen and heard. So now I'm going to read to you. It goes on. I'm just going to read you a short excerpt from the translation so that you have a sense of the book. It's from near the beginning. My maternal grandparents both died before I was born. Grandmother Pina, my mother's mother, was from a modest family and had married a neighbor. Young, diminutive, and bespectacled, my grandfather was at the beginning of his career as a distinguished lawyer. Every day, my grandmother heard him at the front entrance to the building asking the concierge, "Are there any letters for me?" My grandfather pronounced each T emphatically, as if the one word were actually two. This pronunciation impressed my grandmother as a sign of great refinement. She married him because of his pronunciation and because she wanted a black velvet coat for the winter. It was not a happy marriage. When she was young, my grandmother Pina was blonde and pretty. Once she performed in an amateur drama production. When the curtain rose, my grandmother Pina was on stage with a paintbrush and easel. She said these words, "I cannot go on painting. My soul cannot be constrained by toil and art. It flies far from here and is nourished by painful thoughts." My grandfather threw himself into socialism. He was friends with Bisolati, Turati, and Kuleshov. My grandmother Pina stayed out of her husband's political activities because he always packed the house full of socialists. My grandmother Pina used to say bitterly in dialect of their daughter, "That girl's gonna marry the gas man." They ended up living separately. In the last years of his life, my grandfather gave up politics and resumed his practice as a lawyer, but he slept until 5 p.m, and when clients turned up, he would say, "What are they doing here? Send them away." At the end of her life, my grandmother Pina lived in Florence. Sometimes she went to visit my mother, who was married by then and also living in Florence. My grandmother Pina, however, was terrified of my father. One day she came to visit my brother Gino, still a babe in arms, who was running a slight fever. My father was nevertheless very worried, and in an effort to calm him down, my grandmother suggested that the fever was due to teething. My father became furious, insisting that teething did not cause fevers. On her way out, my grandmother Pina met my uncle Silvio, who was also coming to visit us. In dialect, she whispered to him on the steps, "Whatever you do, don't say it's the teeth." Beyond "don't say it's the teeth," "that girl's going to marry the gas man," and "I cannot go on painting," I don't know anything about this grandmother of mine, and no other words of hers came my way. I do remember, however, often hearing repeated in the family this phrase of hers, also in dialect. "Every day it's something, every day something, and today Drusilla's broken her specs." She had three children, Silvio, my mother, and Drusilla, who was short-sighted and always breaking her eyeglasses. My grandmother died alone in Florence after a life full of sorrow. Her eldest child, Silvio, committed suicide when he was 30 by shooting himself in the temple one night in a public park in Milan. After boarding school, my mother left Milan and went to live in Florence. She enrolled at the university to study medicine but never finished her degree because she met my father and married him. My grandmother on my father's side was opposed to the marriage because my mother wasn't Jewish, and someone had told her that my mother was a devout Catholic, that every time she saw a church, she bowed low and made the sign of the cross several times. This was entirely untrue. No one in my mother's family went to church or crossed themselves. So for a while, my grandmother was opposed to the marriage, but then she agreed to try to get to know my mother. They met one evening at the theater and watched a play in which a white woman ended up among black Africans and a black woman who was jealous of her gnashed her teeth and glared at her with terrible eyes and said, "White lady cutlet, white lady cutlet." "White lady cutlet," my mother would always say whenever she ate a cutlet. They'd been given complimentary seats for that play because my father's brother, Uncle Cesare, was a theater critic. He was, this Uncle Cesare, completely different from my father, calm, fat, and always cheerful. As a theater critic, he was not at all caustic and never wanted to say anything bad about a play, finding something positive about each production. When my mother told him that a play seemed stupid to her, he would get mad and said, "Why don't you try to write one yourself?" Later, Uncle Cesare married an actress, a great tragedy for my grandmother. For many years, she didn't want to be introduced to Uncle Cesare's wife because, in my grandmother's opinion, an actress was even worse than a woman who made the sign of the cross. At the time he got married, my father was working in Florence in a clinic run by one of my mother's uncles, nicknamed the Lunatic, because he was a doctor who treated the insane. The lunatic was, in fact, a man of great intelligence, cultivated and wry. I'm not sure if he ever knew what our family called him. In my paternal grandmother's house, my mother encountered a retinue of various Margaritas and Reginas, who were either my father's cousins or aunts, and she also met the renowned La Vendée, who was still alive in those days. As for my grandfather Parente, he's been dead for some time, as was his wife, my grandmother Dolcetta, and their servant known as Beppo the porter. It was known that my grandmother Dolcetta was small and round like a ball and always had indigestion because she ate too much. She felt sick, vomited, then went to bed, but after a little while they would find her eating an egg. "It's so fresh," she'd say by way of justification. Grandfather Parente and grandmother Dolcetta had a daughter called Rosina. Rosina's husband died, leaving her with small children and little money, so she moved back into her father's house. The day after she returned, while everyone was at the dinner table, Grandmother Dolcetta stared at her and said, "What's wrong with our Rosina today? She's not her usual self." My mother used to tell us, and at some length, the stories about our Rosina and Grandmother Dolcetta and the egg, because my father wasn't any good at telling stories, always confusing the facts and details and interrupting himself with his thunderous and prolonged laughter, because memories of his family and his childhood delighted him, making it hard for us to follow him. Enjoying the sheer pleasure of storytelling, my mother was always greatly cheered up whenever she told a story. She would turn to one of us at the dinner table and begin a story, and whether she was telling one about my father's family or about her own, she lit up with joy. It was as if she were telling the story for the first time, telling it to the fresh ears. "I had an uncle," she would begin, "whom they called Barbizon." And if one of us said, "I know that story, I've already heard it 1,000 times, she would turn to another one of us and say in a lowered voice, she would continue with her story. "I can't even begin to count how many times I've heard this story," my father would shout, overhearing a word or two as he passed by. My mother, her voice lowered, would continue on with the story. The lunatic had a madman in his clinic who believed he was God. Every morning the lunatic said to him, "Good morning, most eminent Signor Lippmann." And the madman responded, "Most eminent, perhaps, yes. Lippmann, probably not," because he believed he was God. And then there was the famous line from the orchestra conductor, an acquaintance of Silvio's, who while on tour in Bergamo said to his restless or undisciplined singers, "We haven't come to Bergamo on a military campaign, but to conduct Carmen, Bizet's masterpiece." My parents had 5 children. We now live in different cities, some of us in foreign countries, and we don't write to each other often. When we do meet up, we can be indifferent or distracted. But for us, it takes just one word. It takes one word, one sentence, one of the old ones from our childhood, heard and repeated countless times. All it takes for one of us is to say, "We haven't come to Bergamo on a military campaign," or "Sulfuric acid stinks of fart," and we immediately fall back into our old relationships, our childhood, our youth, all inextricably linked to those words and phrases. If my siblings and I were to find ourselves in a dark cave or among millions of people, just one of those phrases or words would immediately allow us to recognize each other. Those phrases are our Latin, the dictionary of our past. They're like Egyptian or Assyro-Babylonian hieroglyphics, evidence of a vital core that has ceased to exist, but that lives on in its texts, save from the fury of the waters, the corrosion of time. Those phrases are the basis of our family unity and will persist as long as we are in the world, recreated and revived in disparate places on the earth. Whenever one of us says, "Most eminent Senior Lippmann," and we immediately hear my father's impatient voice ringing in our ears, "Enough of that story. I've heard it far too many times already." Thank you.
So those of you who know the original, when I read Jenny's translation, I just wrote to her. I said, you captured the rhythm, you captured the musicality, the phrases land as they do in the original, and of course the humor, and it's no easy feat. So the first question is for you, Jenny, and you know what your experience was of inhabiting this world and its own rhythms and pacing, and then also what did it mean to you to translate Ginzburg now in our current situation we're in?
So I was living in London and I translated this book a while ago. I finished the translation in 2013. And then for reasons of rights problems, I actually thought it was never gonna get published, but I didn't mind because the translation was just so incredible to do, and I learned so much as a writer from translating Natalia Ginzburg. But then it did come out. It came out this year, and of course I was doing all the proofs and going over the copy-edited manuscript and everything as the present political situation was unfolding, and I read a whole new book in a way. A whole deeper levels of it to me were came right to the fore. This is a book that's very much about family, but also about how family and family structures and how a whole family works is actually reflected in society. So and one of the really difficult things when I first started this page, translation, was on the very first page, the father and the patriarch of the family. First of all, she says, "In my father's house," so very much establishes that the patriarch rules and owns the house and the property. And it goes on, though. Then he calls his children Negroes. And that is then explained, and he says things that they are doing are Negroisms. And so when I started this translation, I was like, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do with this? And I looked at previous translations, and one of them had decided to stay away from it entirely and called the children Yahoos. So of course that is sort of difficult in our time to and Yahooisms, and the other translation called stuck with Negro, and then kept it in Italian, and put quotes around it. But in study and really thinking about it, I understood that she was being very, very deliberate by putting a racial slur. What we would now, and it's explained away that this was part of. He was from Trieste, and it was part of their dialect, and it wasn't really a racial slur. It was just, there wasn't really a racial context to it, but she knew what she was doing. And it's what we might call right now microaggression or implicit bias. It's there, and it's constantly working and functioning. And the same goes through the entire book with misogyny and how the mother, the sister, she herself, they're always second-class citizens. And so reading this, it was sort of a primer saying, you know, we're going to always have fascism if we have racism and misogyny in our families and in our culture. So it was hugely revelatory to me again on that level, given where we are.
Thank you. And so picking up also on what it means to decide to translate something today for Anne, you know, what you probably thought about why certain books cry out to be translated at certain times, or new translations of books that have been previously translated. When is it that one feels that there's a need? What is it that has to happen? Does language change? Does politics change? Do you have a... There should be a few mics. Here, I'll give you...
I think there's many reasons that books get retranslated, or get translated, I guess. I mean, one is that people think that the old translation is no good, or they think that the old translation is outdated. The language of the old translation is outdated, which is, of course, often true. There are issues of accuracy, as I said. Maybe there's a translator who really likes a book and wants to translate it, even if it's already been translated. I mean, I actually don't know what the situation was with the with this book.
I have been asking Edwin Frank, who is the head of the New York Review of Books, various projects. I want to translate it. Every time he said no, 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 and then he came to me with this, and it was the one book that I would want to translate most in the world.
Yeah.
So it was serendipitous.
I mean, there are reasons that the rights to something, to a book, become suddenly available, and somebody thinks, oh, that, you know, that looks good. In the case of Primo Levi, there were many reasons to, well, we started out not thinking that we weren't going to, this is the complete works, of thinking that we would not retranslate, we would put together the existing translations, but it turned out that the existing translations had been done at different times. The books were written at different times, but they had been done in kind of a piecemeal fashion. They hadn't been published in English the way they were published in Italian, and by the time you started inserting new translations into collections of old translations, it seemed that you would have something kind of a little bit of a mess. and so then we decided to retranslate everything, and also to have some kind of consistency of style over a lot of different books. With the complete Calvino that's happening, I mean, I think that's a little bit different somehow. Can you say something about that?
Anne has just retranslated a book of my father's, The Baron in the Trees. The reason I wanted it retranslated, the reasons are subjective, I suppose. We always thought in my family that it was a bad translation. It's a very old translation. It was a British, quite British translation, and maybe because I've been living in America for such a long time, I thought that somehow it made the book more limited. A new translation also, especially when an author is dead, it's an opportunity to present the author anew in a fresh way.
Yes.
And so that's something that matters a lot to me. And I don't remember what was the question.
No, I just wonder, I was just saying that you also were dealing with a sort of complete works.
Yeah, yes.
I mean, with a lot of different translators,
yes,
I think.
In France as well. It's a bit of an obsession, and and it's an obsession that few people share. So I'm so happy to be in this panel today. And one thing I would like to say is that there are reviews of translations, And they're very frustrating, because what they usually do is that they say, oh, so this is a new translation, and look at what the old translation said, and look at what the new one says. Instead, if you want to evaluate a translation, you need to go back to the original. Mm-hmm. Just comparing the two translations is not enough. So that's something that, you know, writers, perhaps it's best when writers don't speak any other languages, so that they're not subjected to the anxiety of seeing what happens to their books in other languages.
So we can open up these questions to everybody. But Alessandra, did you feel that this was a book that begged to be translated again now? And how did you feel about the idea, this new?
I don't speak very well English. Va bene, forse meglio. No, voglio dire che in quest'anno era il centenario della nascita di mia madre e quindi ci sono state molte riletture, cerimonie in Italia, in Israele e in altri paesi, e la mia impressione è stata di scoprire quanto sia attuale il suo pensiero, quanto sia ancora vivo. E quindi io sono molto contenta di questa nuova traduzione, tra l'altro sentendola e sapendo a memoria il libro, ho apprezzato moltissimo la musicalità.
Alessandra Ginzburg was saying that this year is the 100th anniversary of her mother's death, and there has been a series of celebrations for her in Italy. Birth. Thank you. See, having a bilingual audience. And there have been celebrations in her honor in Italy, Israel, and many other parts, and it has been an occasion to sort of rediscover the writing of Natalia Ginzburg, and especially to rediscover how contemporary she still is and how relevant she is today. And she was particularly happy about this translation, and today, while she was listening to Jenny reading her translation, knowing the book by heart, she appreciated at the same time the fidelity to the text and the musicality of Jenny's own language.
So, Jhumpa or Lynne, if you, anyone has any, any of you have thoughts about this, the I tempi della traduzione, what time, what, you know, is there a time that you felt that you would want to see a work translated that seems very vibrant to you today, or any of the things we've been discussing?
I first encountered Ginzburg and her work many, many years ago when I was living in Italy. And I took my husband had a Fulbright, and so they sent us all to the Università per Stranieri for 3 weeks so we could have a crash course. So I was put in intermediate because I knew a little bit, and the thing in intermediate was to read Ginzburg, and they're easy. Some of them are very easy in late, piccole virtù, the little virtues. So I absolutely fell in love with them, and that was how I learned to read Italian, and and began translating them. And that was at a time in my life and work when I would undertake, I think Jenny was saying you did this book a long time ago. I don't think I could do it now. I would undertake a big project without any thought of getting it published or how much time it would take or that it would not earn any money. I just did it for love. And I translated a novella of hers, which is still my favorite, called Familia, I think is one of the best things she ever wrote. And I'm still, I still want to polish it up sometime and find a publisher. But I'm sure that if I retranslated it now, it would be different. And as far as the essay, I translated a book of her essays drawn from her three volumes of essays in Italian. And it wasn't that I felt the previous ones were inadequate, they were okay. I didn't really study them very closely, I read them. I translated them because, or retranslated them, because I had the very egotistical idea that only I heard her real voice. And and I still think there's, and like Jenny, of course Jenny hears my real voice too, but that I knew how these essays should sound in English. I could feel them. I just felt it was kind of a transmigration, or there's another word in metempsychosis, that I knew her voice. Anyway, that's why I did them. I felt I had to do them. I could hear her speaking. And I just want to mention one other thing, as long as I'm holding this. I made arrangements to meet her when I was in Italy through a friend who knew her. And I didn't speak Italian very well at that time, but I just felt I had to know her. I had to be in her presence and feel that transmigration happening. So I went to the apartment in the Campo Marzio that she describes in an essay called La Casa. I didn't know what to say. I was very, very young. I didn't know what I was, why I was there, except for this feeling to know, be in her presence. And I was extremely awkward. As she was very nice, she gave me tea. She wasn't very helpful as far as helping, you know, moving on the conversation. She just didn't. I found her very austere, and she was stern. She was stern, and maybe she thought, you know, why is this young person here? And then later, when I was translating her essay, she did an essay about Ivy, the British novelist, Ivy Compton Burnett, called The Great Lady. And I found the precise description of how I felt. And this is another something I felt we had in common. She loved the novels of Ivy Compton Burnett. I mean, she herself, Ginzburg, is a much better novelist, but she loved them anyway. They're very, very spare. I mean, you can't get sparer. It was almost nothing on the page. It was like Henry Green. I mean, you sort of have to write them yourself. So So I found in her essay, this is what she said. It's just a couple of sentences. She was hoping to meet her, and she always hung around the markets and the streets where she felt she might run into her, but she didn't. I didn't care anything about her conversation. I simply wanted to see her and to tell her somehow, in my crude and meager English, how immensely important her books had been to me. Of course, she would have found me absurd. Someone like me could only have struck her as absurd, gratuitous, and sentimental. And I think that's happened with us, but it came through.
Well, thank you. Jhumpa? Would you like to talk about if you felt that an urge at a certain time because of what's happening externally or a language that needs updating, what's the birth of your impulses to translate?
Well, first of all, I just loved what you just shared with us. Thank you so much. That was really beautiful, just to talk about the importance of passion driving the translator. This is fundamental. Well, I've actually had no choice but to translate my whole life. I feel like I was born, in some sense, as a translator, and I think most people who are born with multiple languages feel this, and this is their reality. So I have never inhabited a single linguistic universe ever, and my childhood was about crossing and recrossing on a daily basis, you know, to explain very basic things, either to my parents or to other people, or most of all to myself. So I feel like translation, the act of translation, what it means to live among and between separate languages and to negotiate this, is my experience of being alive. I know no other way of looking at the world. So I'll start with that premise, you know, and then I will move rapidly forward. I think some of the deepest experiences I had as a college student were, I minored in Latin and I studied ancient Greek, and to study those languages, it involves, you know, your kind of rudimentary efforts to translate in order to read. So the act of reading and the act of translation are one. And in fact, the act of translation is, as many people have said, the most intimate form of reading. I would go so far as to say a visceral form of reading, the most active form of reading that there is. And so I remember that experience as, in some sense, I came away, though I majored in English, it was there were the passages of Ovid that was sort of burned into my brain forever, as opposed to all of the things I was reading in English in which I didn't have to take that extra step. When I was a graduate student, I translated some short stories by a Bengali writer named Ashapurna Devi, and this was also a very kind of, well, it was a bit of an unusual translation project in that I cannot read Bengali, which is the language of my mother and father, the language I grew up, my first language, shall we say. I can't read it very well. I don't have a facility to read the language. It's a very oral language for me. So that translation project was involved my mother reading the stories out loud and my tape recording her, and then listening, and then translating from her voice. And this is interesting in retrospect for me to think about. So then we can fast forward a few more decades, and I go down this Italian path, and which is predicated on my decision to read only in Italian, right? So this is a decision I made over 5 years ago now, so quite some time. And from that decision, I believe, came the impulse also to express myself creatively in Italian. For me, writing, translating, and reading are all one world. They're like one eats breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And there are three meals that are different and, you know, they're distinct, but it's all nourishment. And for me, reading and writing and translating, I mean, they're all in circulation, right? And I think this is how it should be. This is how it's supposed to be. And I'm really heartened to find myself on stage today with other writers who translate. This is not normal, sadly, not the norm, I should say, in this country. And I was very struck living in Italy and thinking a lot about, you know, befriending Italian writers and thinking about their journeys, about how in other countries it is absolutely normal and necessary and considered just par for the course for writers, for fiction writers, to translate. I think in America we have poets who translate, who are interested in translation, but we have less fiction writers, novelists who take this step. And I think this is a huge problem in the English-speaking world. In any case, my first translation of Domenico Starnone was born out of that experience of reading a book and connecting to it in a sort of spooky way. You know, I mean, when you really do hear the voice, and I felt that it's not just the voice of the translator, but it's also the mechanisms of the story itself, because of course, as a creative writer as well, it's allowing me a way to read the book that I wouldn't have if I weren't translating it. So when I translate it, I'm going underground and into the boiler room, right? And where everything's really, this is how it's really working. This isn't just the surface of things that we're seeing on the page, on the printed page. It's going underneath in a place where the reader normally doesn't go and where the writer wants to go. The writer wants access to the mechanicals, right? When you see a house and eventually the realtor says, do you want to see the mechanicals? And you need to go down there because, you know, that's how the house really functions. So for the writer, I think translation is that opportunity to really go down there and see what is happening on the most minute level. So, you know, when I translate, I'm now translating another novel by Starnone, the pleasure of it is obvious in just in terms of being in the world of his language and the constant learning process that comes with translating a writer who's, you know, whose command of language is so extraordinary. But the other thing, the added benefit, I think, for a fiction writer to translate fiction, for example, in my case, is that I am seeing it's like he's putting the brush in my hand and saying, look, this is how I did it. And it's a different experience from looking at the painting. So this is a very powerful experience for me. And I feel that it's just a necessary, you know, a necessary piece of the whole of my experience as a creative person.
Mm-hmm. Jenny, would you? I just wanted to see what Jenny has to say as a writer as well as a translator on this subject. And by the way, as someone who works on fascists, I do envy all of you because the transmigration and communion thing, you really don't want to have it with your subjects when you work on. You need that like alienation kind of, but.
Yeah, I love everything that you said. It's so true. I really feel like in doing translation that you're coming out of another language. You're translating out of another language. But the really important thing, that language is beautiful. I love Italian. I love getting to know it. But translating is really for me about getting to know English. And the whole metaphor of the getting down into the guts of the language is actually also about the English. You really, as a translator, you very, very slowly, because it's a slow process, have to understand what your language can do, its limitations, and where it flies and soars, and where it just fails, and. And so for me, that's, it's a really intimate relationship with this other author who's mentoring you, but at the same time, it's also this experience of your own in your relationship with your own language.
Anne or Lynn, would you like to add?
Well, I'm not a fiction writer. But certainly it's the same. It's that same impulse to study your own language. I mean, the things that you don't know about it, the things that it, as you say, that it can and can't do. But it is very much, well, for me, it's very much on the level of words and sentences. I don't really think about the book too much because there's so much in every in all the building blocks of the book. It is a lot about learning your own language and about being able to express yourself in your own language.
Yes, well, I've had the same experience. And when I began translating these Ginzburg essays, it was a long time ago when I was in an intermediate class, and then I came home and kept doing it, and people asked, well, you don't know Italian very well. How can you really do this? I said, yes, but my English is very, very good. I always felt that was what enabled me to translate. Of course you have to know Italian, but I think more you have to use your own language. And as far as what Jhumpa was saying, as I went on and did more translation, people would ask, things like, well, you know, you're a novelist. Why are you doing this? As if it were some kind of a lesser activity. And I agree that they all are related. They're all the same. A translator is really a writer. Not that she doesn't need another name. It's a worthy name. I love to do it because I'm doing what I love about writing. I hate doing the first draft and making things up and having it, you know, work or have some kind of meaning. I find that all the drudgery. But when I get to the second draft and I just play with the words, that is the best part. And I love translating because I can do exactly that, but I don't have to make it up. It's all made up for me. Yes, it's just done. All I have to do is tinker or look at what you call the mechanicals, you know, go down and play with the whatever's down there in the basement. So that's why it's true, you all probably know that this country has one of the, I don't know the statistics, but one of the fewest translated books are here.
It's, I need to say it because it's really horrifying that it's the 3%. So we publish in America and England, 3% of our books are translations, whereas in Italy, I think it's 55%. In France, it's similar, so 3%. And then I just have to add this, that of that 3%, it's 0.6% are women who are translated into English. Just need to get that in there.
Vorrei dire qualcosa su mia madre come traduttrice. Mia madre ha tradotto alcuni libri molto importanti dal francese, tra cui il primo volume di Proust, La strada di Swann, quando era giovanissima ed era al confino con mio padre e aveva un piccolissimo dizionario che si chiamava Ghiotti, pessimo, e mio padre le aveva spiegato che doveva cercare ogni singola parola, anche casa, e lei diligente cercava. Le prime volte lui le disse che queste traduzioni erano bruttissime, e però qualcosa poi successe, perché effettivamente lei riuscì a tradurre questo primo volume, e certamente ci sono stati degli errori che poi sono stati corretti, però è stata una bella traduzione. E quando il critico Giacomino De Benedetti, che poi si ritrova in Lessico familiare come il giovane piccolo, scrisse una critica di questa traduzione, notò che c'erano alcuni aspetti del linguaggio familiare che ritornavano nel linguaggio di Proust. E quindi in qualche modo aveva anticipato questa visione del lessico che ancora doveva nascere. E in seguito lei ha riflettuto molto sulla traduzione, ha scritto delle belle introduzioni alle sue traduzioni, rivendicando anche i suoi errori e dicendo che era importante che il traduttore servisse il testo, che fosse un servitore del testo. Però io credo che, essendo lei una scrittrice, appunto, questo abbia molto influito nel suo modo di tradurre.
Oh, figurati. So Alessandra wanted to talk about her mother as a translator, and as a very young woman, she translated the first book of Proust. Qual è il titolo in francese? Le Côté de chez Swann. The first book, and she was very young, and she was in confino, that would be internal exile. Ruth, is that correct? With her father, with Alessandra's father, and he told her that she should look up every single word in the dictionary, even the words that she knew, like casa, like house. And she had a very small, very bad dictionary called Ghiotti, but that's all they had. And the translation, of course, had some mistakes and some faults, but at the same time, the final version is a good translation. And Natalia Ginzburg went back to these translations, also in introductions to her own translations and reflections on what it means to translate. And she was very proud of what she did as a translator, and as she said, even of her own mistakes. And at the same time, she would say that the translator has to serve the original text. And that's the reflection.
Well, Natalia and the other writers who are described in the book who worked in this wonderful new publishing house, they were all translators. All of them, and it was part of what made them so wonderful. And I can't really think, because I have to talk about myself and my emotions, because Alessandra looks a lot like her mom, and we moved, when my family moved to Rome from Paris, my father bought the house that was across the street from their house, And across the street, and the street is one of those medieval vicoli, so it's maybe 2 meters. And I just, I don't know, I want to tell anecdotes, and so I... And then rereading the book through Jenny's translation, I saw that my godmother is in the book, which I had completely forgotten. And so it's very moving. And remember that my father and Natalia went to see Hemingway. Yes. I don't know anything about that, but I just know that they went to see. They had lots of adventures.
Yeah. We'll get to those. I just wanted to actually ask Ruth a question, because under fascism, translation was banned. Isn't that right? It wasn't.
Yeah.
I thought they weren't allowed. I've read that. No.
American movies
and all translations of America, and that's why after the war there was this great resurgence in translation? No, I'm making that up.
Yes and no. There was one of the things I was shocked to find when I started doing the book a long time ago on fascist culture is that there was this kind of politics of apparent openness, and there was this policy that the fascists were following that they wanted to kind of catch up with the rest of Europe and America and then do one better, become better, because this was like fascism was going to be a superior form. So I was very surprised to discover that there were these a huge amount of translations. There were both in the form of reviews that had the latest Dos Passos. James Joyce was translated as soon as it appeared, everything. Now this is early on. Then what happens by the time we get toward the World War II, there's this kind of, it's a different cultural moment and political moment, and they start cracking down on translations, but they continued until the end. It was just, it often depended who the translator was going to be. If you were in political exile yourself, or you were viewed with ambivalence by the regime, what you wanted to translate would be much more scrutinized. So it was very clientelistic. But this also makes me think about, you know, we don't often think about as historians, when depending on what kind of work we do, but if you want to do a lively history, you're translating primary sources of people's voices from the time, and you come to it, and you are responsible for translating their words in a way that is legible to contemporary people. So we engage in more translation as part of our job than one would think, right? So, but this these comments of Giovanna in particular can lead to something else that Jenny and I wanted to ask the panel about, and we phrased it first for Jhumpa, you know, about the question of being faithful to the text, and also the question of boundaries. Like, to what extent does your personal world or your familial world or intrude on the text? This is like implicit bias, other or familial emotions that are hard to contain. And how do you all confront this, or maybe if it is an issue at all?
Well, two things. I wanted to just mention the publication of Americana was in 1941. This is the anthology of Vittorini, which is very important to bring into the discussion. I think 33 authors, American authors' voices translated for the first time in Italy, a book that sort of shapes profoundly a generation and represents something both political and artistic, you know, a real touchstone, for writers, readers as well, but writers especially. And you have writers, you know, you have translations by Moravia, you have translations by Pavese, you have, you know, the great voices, as I was saying, you know, translating this very
sort of groundbreaking work. I mean, bringing these American, bringing Hemingway, bringing Fitzgerald, bringing Hawthorne, bringing Melville for the first time into Italian. This is, you know, this is revolutionary. This is revolution. You know, this is what it is. So I think it's important to just remember that, you know, this extraordinary work. But the question you asked, sorry, Ruth, was about boundaries. I actually, Jenny came yesterday to Princeton, where I teach, and we talked about, she visited my translation class, and then she gave a lovely reading with a colleague of mine in the Italian department, and we'd had a nice bilingual reading, a bit like tonight. But it was in rereading this extraordinary book, Lessico Familiare, which means so much to all of us, but has meant so much to me as a person and as a writer. And in rereading it, revisiting both the Italian and looking at Jenny's Hughes translation, I think Natalia Ginzburg herself has provided me, at least, with a new way to think of how the translator must position him or herself. And I think it's all in the preface that you all heard, and this idea of you know, the lacuna of what is missing. This is a book that is predicated on absence. It is a highly contradictory text in that you have a first person narrator who barely talks about herself. This is not a memoir. This is not what we have come to know in our culture today in 2017 as a memoir, where someone writes a book about him or herself and talks all about him or herself and his or her own feelings. This is the anti-memoir in some sense. And yet it is a book narrated in the first person, you know, and it is a very personal book and touches on some of the most painful of human experiences, a devastating book, but narrated in such a strange, experimental, radical way, with such odd proportions, nothing predictable about it. And the point I'm trying to make is that I think it's this very contradiction of Natalia as being both incredibly present and also absent in this book. I think that, for me, in recent days, has been a new illumination in terms of what my role as a translator is, which is that I have to aim toward exactly what she achieved in this book, which is that full presence. It is I, every page, she is there. My parents, my father, my mother, you know, so it's assumed that she's there, because the whole thing is from her punto di vista. There is no other. And yet she's not there. And this is an extraordinary thing she did. And for some reason, people have not learned from this incredible model. Instead, we've gone the other direction, and everyone just talks about themselves, right? But I think for the translator, dropping everything, has to straddle this and play this contradictory role. The translator has to be both everywhere and nowhere at the end. Right, they have to be behind every word, every sentence. They have to take full responsibility for each choice, but they also have to disappear, right? And let the work sing, right? And to capture that voice somehow, and to not blanket the voice of the author and take over. So it's an equilibrium that is very difficult to achieve. But I think in the ideal translation, you do have a sort of harmony between two voices across time and space. But it is a harmony that is you know, it's achieved by the translator, because the writer writes, you know, in a place, in time, in a moment, and doesn't assume that he or she will be translated, right? We don't know. When I write a book, I don't know if it will be translated. I just write it, and I put all my energy into writing it. But the translator is working with a pre-existing text and has his or her own voice to bring, the language of the translator is you know, it can't not be there, right? You have to, and the voice and the choices of the translator. So it's this equilibrium, and I think if one reads Lessico Familiare, one understands the exact mechanism of this. So I think it's a wonderful comment. I mean, it's a comment on so many things. This book is so rich thematically. But I think for me, it's also a brilliant comment, or just a tool for me, I suppose, as a reader, of how to think about how to position myself as a translator.
Yeah, I'd love to hear what you all have to say about that.
In a way, to summarize what you just said, a great translator has no ego, and the best job that a translator can do is to produce a text where you don't think of the translator. So it's an act of self-effacement. So Baudelaire translated Edgar Allan Poe, and sometimes I think when a great author translates another great author, it can be a great translation, or it can turn into something else. It can turn into a great text of Baudelaire, but then it's something else.
Yeah. Can I say something about this? That's the temptation is very strong to get yourself in there. I didn't feel that way when translating Ginzburg because of what I said before. I felt she had already occupied me, and I didn't have to do a thing but do the words. But I translated before that a Holocaust memoir by a woman who's a journalist. She wrote it when she was very young, and I wanted to do it. I didn't feel, I mean, because I felt a great affinity with the subject, but not with her or her style, but I wanted to do it as kind of a service. I felt it was a book that needed to be appear in English. But as I went along, I kept trying to make it better. You know, I kept thinking, you know, this sentence would read so much better if it just had this or that. I wanted to make it a little more elegant. She was writing as a journalist, writing about the people around her. And I wanted to get in there as a novelist and give it these little kind of decorations or stylistic elegances that I had to control myself. And this, I had to realize this is her book. This is not mine. I have to show who she is, whatever she is. And she's a very good writer, but very different from me. So it is tempting. That's all I have to say.
Anne, do you have? Well, I mean, I would just say that I try not to have myself in the book, in the translated book. I mean, I don't think it's a conscious effort. I mean, I think it's, I think that I find that if I'm staying with the text pretty closely, I'm not, I like to think that I'm not there, that it's just the author speaking.
Yesterday, so translation is a deeply, deeply intimate act, as Jhumpa and I were discussing yesterday. And during our days, along the way, this metaphor that's came out, that I can't remember who did it, but, and you helped me with it, but the translation is like a snail. So, and you're really getting into the muck. So the snail at the bottom is very slimy and kind of gross, and lots of lots of taste buds that is going slowly, slowly, slowly over a text. And for me, that's what translation is like. And so, you know, you're definitely, as a translator, you're very in it and very much part of, you're the snail going over the pages.
Others, would you like to comment on do family or other things, is it difficult to separate that for you?
No, you don't want to.
Okay. Okay, so any other, because I'd like to leave time for questions from the audience. So anyone have a last, Alessandra, would you like to say something before we open for questions?
Beh, voglio dire che per me è un'esperienza molto emozionante essere qui e sentire parlare in maniera così profonda degli scritti di mia madre e anche della sua traduzione. Mi ha colpito molto quello che ha detto Jhumpa, perché ritengo che effettivamente è stato così, che lei nel lessico era contemporaneamente molto presente e molto assente. E quando lei nella prefazione dice che è molto difficile parlare di sé, io credo che abbia detto una cosa enorme, cioè che effettivamente in tutta la sua scrittura è molto difficile trovare delle emozioni che vengono esplicitate in maniera chiara, cioè sia le emozioni molto dolorose che quelle molto di felicità che sono state concentrate nei pochi anni di matrimonio con mio padre, non vengono mai espresse in maniera esplicita, ma piuttosto diciamo si ritrovano in qualche pagina, in qualche riga in cui lei dice non solo che è difficile parlare di sé, ma mi ha colpito per esempio che a un certo punto in una intervista alla radio le viene chiesto di che cosa è successo quando mio padre è andato a Roma prima di lei e prima di noi e dopo è stato immediatamente arrestato e lei ha detto Leone è andato via, che era un modo di dire molto familiare ma nello stesso tempo celava la tragedia che c'era dietro questo. Ecco, io credo che questo sia un esempio molto caratteristico di come lei nascondeva i suoi sentimenti, ma li faceva intendere fra le righe.
Alessandra mentions that l'inizio soltanto, scusa Alessandra. That the point is that it's difficult to talk about yourself, and first of all, she thanked the panel, and she's moved of the things that she heard tonight about her mother and her writings, and talking about the difficulty about talking about yourself. She agrees with what Jhumpa said, that Natalia Ginzburg is very present and at the same time very absent from her own book, and one example of her personality that. Refused to talk about herself or talk to herself in a very elusive manner is, for example, in the book, there are no prolonged descriptions of her great pain that she experienced in her life and even of the great joy concentrated in the years of the short marriage with your father. It's a couple of sentences, very light, not indulging in expressing her own emotions. And the key to understand that is in a radio interview that she gave. And when the journalist that interviewed her asked her about the moment in which Leone Ginzburg went back to Rome, only to be arrested shortly after, she just said, Leone andato via, Leone went away. That it's a very familiar expression and at the same time represents an immense tragedy with a very familiar language.
And that's a wonderful place to transition to questions. And if you could please keep your questions brief and also keep them, since this is a panel on language, make sure the questions are questions and not something other than that, let's say. So someone in the back, yes. Can you stand up? Do you mind standing up? Because it's easier to hear.
La domanda è quando era la prima sua prima traduzione quella di Proust?
Sì. Sì. Aveva 23 anni.
So you were asking if it was her first translation? It was. Oh no, it was her first translation, and she was 23 years old when she. When did she? Quando ha cominciato di fare la traduzione? Perché era pubblicato nel 1954, così? Took her about 10 years. Sorry.
Yes.
I have a question for Jenny. You said you basically finished a draft or pretty much finished it in 2013. When you went back to go over it before, even the copy editing and stuff like that, what surprised you, or did you find that you changed things, or how was that in your process to go back after a couple of years to the text and see how you felt about it now?
Okay, so, oh yes, the question is, how did I feel about finishing it in 2013 and then going back to read it in 2017, apart from the sort of political thing that I said before? Okay, so I'm sort of embarrassed to say this, but I thought it was terrific. And really, it just felt like I was reading the book as I had when I had first read it when I was 20 years old, but in English. So it was real joy. Just, and for me, even though there's so much dark and pain, she is a profoundly joyful writer. And so that was great.
Yes.
To daughter of Natalia, thank you so much for your what you've said about her, because we are all profound fans. I'm almost wondering if there's something about, I've only read her in translation, but it's almost as if she's always present in accent in her sentences, because you try to look at them and see what she's doing, and frankly, I can't figure it out. And I'm going to say this, and this is the wrong word, but I can't figure out, and it's almost like dry ice. There's something deceptive. She's so deceptively simple. I don't know, maybe the translators, and maybe it has something to do with her shyness, being there and not there. There and not there. Yeah. Add anything to that, like, as you translated her, the style is so separate and unique from anything I've ever read.
Absolutely.
Right? Translated.
Jenny?
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I agree with that. That's absolutely true in everything that has been said about her being both present and absent. But there are other places, for example, in novels and also in the essays, where she's very direct. For example, in Lessico Familiare, she says, she talks, the father is always yelling. He's always yelling and screaming and frightening everyone. And it almost becomes comic. It is comic at moments. But it's only in the essays when she says something like, she was terrified. She said, I live, in one of her essays, she says, I lived in holy dread of him. Or she'll say, the objects hurled were on the alert for the edge of violence in their voices. That's not in Lessico Familiare. It's we see it more as a comic. I don't want to put him down. He's important, but people don't seem to get truly frightened by him. But he was, and also about Leone Ginzburg. I'll just let it lie there. They can lie there too. Yes, she passes over his death very sparsely. She doesn't say a lot. But then in an essay called Human Relations, she's
talking about the difficulty of being widowed with three little children. We is her, she uses the plural. We're no longer afraid of death. We gaze at death every hour, every minute, recalling its great silence on the face we love the most. That to me is one of the most poignant sentences she's ever written, and it's so short. But finally she says what we want to hear. It's almost what's the word when you want to, you're digging, you want to enjoy people's grief. I don't mean enjoy that we're glad it happened, but you want to get into it somehow. And that's one of the places where she lets that happen. And there are many places where she does that. But I think in this book, Lessico Familiare, she deliberately doesn't. It's not about her feelings. She put her feelings elsewhere.
I love what you said about sort of the unknowable aspect of her. It's unidentifiable how she does it in this incredibly simple language. But it's simple, yet it has just so many layers because of that incredible simplicity. It allows us to see so much more there. But, also, she does this thing all the time, which is, I think, sort of... it's a female kind of thing, where she is constantly coming up against her shyness and her self-doubt, and then overcoming it. And it's that this sort of cyclical thing that she goes through all the time in her writing, and you can sort of see it happen. And I really recommend her her essay, which is called Il mio mestiere, or My Craft, in which she talks about what it's like to be a writer, a woman, a mother, and all the battles that she has to go through all the time in order to make those words happen on the page. And I think we're watching that somewhat, that unidentifiable or thing that in her simple language. And that's how she found, that was how she found her way to express herself.
Credo che un aspetto importante della sua esperienza fosse di essere la bambina più piccola in famiglia. I fratelli erano molto più grandi e lei assisteva alle loro liti, alle loro discussioni, sentiva tutti questi discorsi, essendo contemporaneamente una bambina, ma anche molto attenta a registrare questi modi di dire, perché erano tutti poi rimasti nella sua mente. E a volte anche addirittura prendeva appunti, e i suoi fratelli la prendevano in giro e dicevano: come mai fai questo? E io credo che lei istintivamente tutta la sua vita abbia fatto questo. Quando ha scritto La famiglia Manzoni, per esempio, in fondo ha riscritto Lessico familiare. Mi dimentico sempre che devi
tradurre. As a very young girl, she was the youngest daughter in the family, and she had much older brothers that would have quarrels and discussions about all sorts of things. And she would not only listen as a little girl would, but she would like record in her memory, and sometimes also she would take notes, and her brothers would make fun of her. So what are you writing down? And that was her way of appropriating of these expressions and making them become hers. And a further proof of this is that also when she writes about the Manzoni, La Famiglia Manzoni, another of her great books, somehow it's a rewriting of Lessico Familiare applied to yet another complicated family.
Sorry, it just makes me remember really quick my Craft, she does write about that. She says she came from this family and she had these brothers, and if she wanted to say anything at the dinner table, she had to say it really fast and really simply. So maybe our explanation is there.
So we have to stop, but a huge thank you to everyone, and to Jenny, whose translation made tonight possible. Thank you, and Alessandra. Thank you all.